I have long picked up that there are parallels between current defenses of the King James Version and Reformation-era Catholic defenses of the Latin Vulgate. So it was with some interest that, upon the recommendation of my great friend Timothy Berg, in an interview on this very channel, in fact, I picked up a nice printing of multiple English Bible prefaces, including that of the Douay-Rheims Catholic Bible of 1582, a translation into English. In this video, I want to talk through two major things. I want to talk about places where the Catholic translators, where their thinking does not overlap with the thinking of modern King James defenders, and places where their arguments definitely do overlap. And today you're going to get a little tour of some beautiful spots in West Virginia where I am visiting some friends of the channel. The preface to the Rheims New Testament of 1582 opens by speaking in a markedly Catholic way that came as a shock to my Protestant sensibilities. I almost couldn't believe they were actually saying these things out loud. See how you take it. The Catholic translators actually spend a great deal of time wondering out loud whether or not it's even a good idea to translate the Bible into the language of the people. They argue repeatedly that it's probably not a good idea for Christians in normal circumstances to read their Bibles. They say that they do not generally and absolutely deem it more convenient in itself and more agreeable to God's word and honor or edification to the faithful to have God's word turned into vulgar tongues, and of course they mean translated, rather than kept and studied only in the ecclesiastical learned languages. So why did the English Catholics of the late 16th century even bother to translate the Bible into English at all? They argue that the Protestant Reformation basically forced them to do it. It forced their hand. I find it just so incredible as a lifelong Protestant to read that Bible translation might be profitable and medicinable now, they say, though otherwise, in the peace of the Church, it is neither much requisite nor perchance wholly tolerable. The Catholic translators in the preface to the Rheims New Testament point out that translations in England were never wholly forbidden, but in quiet and better times, they say, when people were not so prone to alteration, heresy, or novelty, such translations were not hastily admitted. And they were not, they say, ordinarily read of the vulgar, that means by the common people, but were used only or specially of some devout religious and contemplative persons in reverence, secrecy, and silence for their spiritual comfort. They say that, quote, the Church neither generally permits that which will necessarily do hurt to the unworthy, in other words, we're talking about Bible translation, therefore Bible reading, nor absolutely condemns that which may do much good to the worthy. Okay, so I'm reading this and I'm wondering, what makes a Christian worthy to read a Bible translation in their own language? They say that Bibles should not be read indiscriminately by all people, but only people who have express license thereunto. They have to have a good testimony from their curates and confessors. They have to be humble, discreet, and devout persons. And they have to be likely to take much good and suffer no harm thereby. That is, again, by reading the Bible. Again, by reading a translation of the Bible into their own language, they might be harmed. It's hard not to see this as saying people who end up using their Bible reading to disagree with the Catholic Church don't get to have a Bible in their own language. To me, this is just dark stuff. The Protestant vision is directly contradicted here. We must not imagine that in the primitive church, they say, everyone, you know, got to read the Bible, or that, quote, our forefathers suffered every schoolmaster, scholar, or grammarian that had a little Greek or Latin to take in hand the Holy Testament, or that the translated Bibles, they say, were in the hands of every husbandman, that means farmer, artificer, apprentice, boys, girls, mistress, maid, man. They deny that the scriptures were sung, played, alleged by every tinker, taverner, rhymer, or minstrel. They deny that the scriptures were there for, quote, table talk for ale benches, for boats and barges, for every profane person and company. I find all of this to be just incredibly sad. They, too, take the plowboy, the poor plowman, they call him, as the stand-in for the man on the street. They have clearly heard the cry of William Tyndale, the martyr. And yet they say that the plowman could then, and that is in centuries past, in laboring the ground, sing the hymns and songs either in known or unknown languages, as they heard them in the Holy Church, though they could neither read nor know the sense, meaning, and mysteries of the same. In other words, they don't need Bible translations. The plowboy doesn't need them. We might wonder today what possible benefit could the plowman get out of singing songs in Latin that he learned in church. They answer that the scriptures must be delivered in measure and discretion according to each man's need and capacity. Of course, you have to wonder who's going to make that judgment, right? And who lacks the need for the Bible? What Christian lacks the need for the Bible? And as for capacity, over and over again as I read this section, I just found myself wondering, how are you supposed to grow in capacity and worthiness to read the Bible if you don't have the Bible? I wrote a big wow next to this, for example. They basically argue that wise people reject the Protestant argument that the scriptures are made for all men, and it's actually out of envy that the priests keep the holy book from this plowman, the plowboy. They say that this argument from the Protestants comes from the same serpent that seduced our first parents, who persuaded them that God had forbidden them that tree of knowledge, lest they should be cunning as himself, and like unto the highest. They're saying that vernacular Bible translation is like the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. It's not really appropriate for everyone, not every Christian. They basically say, well, okay, we have to translate the Bible, and the Catholic man in these days does need to know it, because our adversaries, the Protestants, the Reformation, are industrious to impeach our belief. Catholics need to be skillful in the scriptures right now, they're saying, even though at other times, when the church has no such enemies, when it's enjoying peace, we don't really need lay people to know the Bible. The first many pages of this preface to a translation into English just feel like the translators are being dragged, kicking and screaming into doing any translating in the first place. I won't say that these men in 1582 had nothing of truth to say. They speak of people, for example, who find no difficulty in the sacred book clasped with seven seals. That is, people who read the book of Revelation and feel like they know immediately and exactly what all of the arcane symbols mean, and who confidently inform everyone else that their interpretation is wrong and theirs is right. These late 16th century Catholics are also right to criticize people who ask for no exposition with the holy eunuch. They're citing the Acts 8 passage in which the Ethiopian eunuch says, "How can I understand this without a teacher?" And of course, Philip is sent to help him. In other words, the Catholics there are criticizing people who think they need no help at all reading the Bible. And I think that the presumption that they talk about really does exist, but that it doesn't have to. They also talk about people who won't study long enough to understand the Bible. And yes, of course, that happens today all over the place, all over the world. But I really don't think responsible Protestants are recommending that people refuse to listen to gifted Bible teachers, or that they start writing commentaries the third week after they get saved. We do recommend long Bible study and growth in that ability. People who get to teach in all the churches that I've been in, they go through training, they go through vetting. And those many or most Protestant groups which presume an educated ministry, educated pastors, at least implicitly presume that long study is necessary for teaching the Bible in an official pastoral role. I am so thankful to have grown up with Protestant presuppositions about Scripture, because I think they're biblical. And I am certainly including in my gratitude the King James Onlyists who taught me back in high school. It's not like we were unaware, even in that church, that people misuse the English Bible, that they misinterpret it. But our prescription for bad Bible reading was more Bible reading, not taking the Bible away from people until they become worthy somehow to read it again. I think that view was fundamentally right because, again, of the teachings of the Bible itself. We are commanded to search the scriptures in various ways, from the example of David, who made God's law his meditation all the day, to that of the Bereans, who search the scriptures daily to validate Paul's gospel message. The word of God makes wise the simple, Psalm 19 says. This is impossible to imagine without Bible translation into the languages of the people around the world. There is much more Catholic teaching to disagree with in this preface, but let me turn now to where I see unfortunate, unwitting agreement and overlap between the bibliological arguments of the Catholics of 1582 and those of certain King James defenders today. I'm going to offer a fair number of parallels. First, they challenge Protestants to put up or shut up. Has Bible reading made people better, for example, they ask. They write, look whether your men be more virtuous, your women more chaste, your children more obedient, your servants more trusty, your maids more modest, your friends more faithful, your laity more just in dealing, your clergy more devout in praying. Look whether there be more religion, fear of God, in all states now than of old, when there was not so much reading, chatting, and jangling of God's word, but more sincere dealing, doing, and keeping the same. I'm not sure how that can happen when you're not reading the Bible, but anyways. In other words, the existence of vernacular Bible translations in English did not seem to the Catholic Bible translators to have improved morals. I think this is a bit of a lazy argument because morality is rather hard to measure, and because England was still a society with a state church, and that always produces quite a bit of nominalism of people who are Christians in name only. How is this parallel to today's defenses of the King James Version? Well, I frequently hear King James defenders say something like, the modern versions were supposed to increase the readability of the Bible, but are people reading the Bible more? No, their morals are worse. The Christian church in America is in a terrible state. So let me answer this one right away, and I'll answer the Catholics and the modern day Protestants who have taken up the same line in defense of the King James. It does matter whether people live holy lives, yes, obviously, but you don't judge the success of a Bible translation by how well people obey the Bible. We are told to teach people everything that Christ commanded. We are told to use language they can understand so they can be edified. But what they do with that is up to them. We need to obey those passages I just mentioned, whether we like the consequences or not. And I just question whether correlation equals causation, whether anyone other than God can discern that the reason why we have such terrible prosperity gospel preachers on TV, for example, is the advent of modern English Bible translations. I just don't see any causation there. I rather think the opposite. Wherever the Bible goes with greater clarity because it speaks the English we speak, it will do more good. I don't know that I can do much more than argue to a draw here, because how in the world can anyone prove their answer either way here, given that correlation-causation thing? The next big parallel that I see between Catholics of that era and modern-day King James defenders is that the Catholics acknowledge, well, maybe it's not so bad in principle that the Bible is being translated into the vulgar language, but actually the Protestant translations themselves are just bad. They've abused the people, they say. They've produced false translations. They've given people their own wicked writing and fantasies. They corrupt both the letter and the sense by false translation, adding, detracting, altering, transposing, pointing, and all other guileful means, especially where it serveth for the advantage of their private opinions. Now, I myself cannot deny that this sort of thing can happen. I have alleged this very kind of thing against the New World Translation, at least in particular passages, and much more narrowly, one verse in the NRSV updated edition. But clearly, just because the Catholics and the contemporary KJV defenders charge that this has occurred doesn't mean that it absolutely has occurred. And I observe that when the Catholics of 1582 actually get into the details, it's all rather abstruse and complex. Sometimes I knew the issues they were raising, issues of translation, issues of textual criticism. Sometimes I had to look them up in order to understand what they were arguing. And as I read and worked through some of these charges they were making, I kept thinking, there's just no way around the intellectual difficulty here. Most people are not called or equipped to do this kind of multilingual work. And when you come right down to it, most Christians are going to have to trust the word of someone who knows Hebrew or Greek. Again, I just don't see any way around this. They're going to have to trust someone to judge whether a particular rendering in a particular place is accurate or not. The question for lay people then, as now, in 1582, as in today, is which scholars are trustworthy? I've addressed this question elsewhere on this channel. I will address it here only very briefly. I'd suggest that if your viewpoint, whether Catholic or King James only, requires you to believe that apparently sincere, doctrinally sound, highly trained Christian Bible translators are all secretly corrupting the Bible on purpose, you've fallen into a conspiracy theory. The parallels between early Reformation-era Catholic views and those of current King James defenders become even more striking, I think, when we arrive at the Catholics' list of reasons for translating from the Latin Vulgate instead of from the Hebrew Bible and Greek New Testament, a decision the Catholic Church has later reversed, I believe. Most of the arguments in this long section of their preface have perfect parallels among modern King James defenders. It's really striking. First, the Catholic translator's first argument is that the Latin Vulgate has been used for a long, long time. They use the word ancient to describe it. And this, of course, was true then, as it is today. It's also true of the King James, except maybe that word ancient. It's not been used quite that long. Now, I am a conservative. I tend toward the slow iteration, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, philosophy of life and culture. And I think that both the Vulgate and the King James made many choices that are worth preserving. They started traditions or continued them in translation and text that I think were good. But I also think that each generation must have the freedom to take our traditional Bible translations back to the Hebrew and Greek to ask whether indeed they need to be revised due to language change or to minor updates in our understanding of various ancient Hebrew and Greek words. It just cannot be right to maintain whatever traditions happen to make it down to us for the sole reason that they've survived the centuries. Neither should we remove them just because we've forgotten why they exist. We have to figure out, as G.K. Chesterton famously said, what their original purpose was. Why was this fence originally built before you remove it? And let me tell you, the original purpose of any Bible translator is to make God's word intelligible to those who speak the language into which that Bible is being translated. I am completely certain that if the King James translators heard that their translation was being regarded as the last English translation of all time, as practically inspired, as impossible to be improved upon or updated, they would rend their garments and run into the crowd like Paul and Barnabas at Lystra crying, "Sirs, why do you do these things? We also are men of like passions with you." The principle of translation into the language of the people is the ancient thing that must be preserved. Not because it's ancient, but because it's biblical. Second, the Douay-Rheims translators appeal to major names who are trusted by their audience. They appeal to Jerome and Augustine and the fathers who all endorse the Latin Vulgate, they say. I would not say that this strategy of argument is wrong in itself, nor is it wrong in itself for King James defenders to cite the many, many trusted people who have praised and trusted the King James Version. I praise and I trust the King James Version to this day. But would Jerome or Augustine or any of the church fathers endorse the Latin Vulgate Bible translation for use among English-speaking Christians of 1548? Or of 2023? I highly, highly doubt it. And would Spurgeon or Matthew Henry or the King James translators themselves, would they insist that the translation choices in the King James are all sacrosanct, never ever to be amended, even as English changes over time? Would the translators of Isaiah 14:23 say to us, "We chose the word besom, and well, we don't care if you say broom nowadays in your English. Teach people to use a dictionary. What we have written, we have written." Do you think they would say that? I highly doubt it. Just because trusted people endorsed a Bible translation does not mean that they reject all others, even those yet future. Third, the next argument that the Catholics of 1582 use for the Vulgate is most definitely alive and well among King James defenders. The Douay-Rheims translators point out that a church council, namely the Council of Trent, declared the Latin Vulgate to be the standard for all doctrinal controversies. The most direct parallel among modern King James defenders is to be found among people who look to the Westminster Confession and who argue that whatever those Presbyterian divines, whom I respect greatly, believe to be authentical, and that word meant authoritative, is what we must accept as authoritative. There is a looser parallel in IFB King James defense, the argument that we have to have a standard translation or we have no doctrinal standard. If there are multiple translations, people of this way of thinking say, then they say that's the same thing as having multiple different Bibles, which is the same thing as having no Bible. This argument is everywhere among Calvinistic and non-Calvinistic King James defenders. People find it persuasive, and I get it. It's a little disconcerting to be told that the ultimate standard for doctrinal controversies lies in Hebrew and Greek if you can't read those languages. But how often do Christian doctrines hinge on only a few passages, and passages that are hard to translate, where there are disputed translation choices? I can't even think of an example. The fear many people have of what will happen if the church uses multiple Bible translations instead of just one is, I think, almost totally unfounded. If anything, English readers ought to be grateful that they don't have to take the word of only one set of translators, whether 17th century ones or 20th century ones, when there are doctrinally significant passages that do get translated a little bit differently in different English and Spanish and Urdu Bible translations around the world. Seeing how these passages are rendered in Bibles around the world will almost always be helpful and not confusing to the discerning reader. And the funny thing is that the King James translators bring up this issue raised by the Douay-Rheims translators in the King James preface. Miles Smith answers them. The King James translators were certainly responding to the Catholics 29 years later when they put out their own preface. They say this explicitly, actually, and they answer this particular point. They say that if anyone is fearful that the existence of marginal notes providing alternate translations will make it impossible to use Scripture for the deciding of controversies, they cannot help this. They argue that this is simply the way that language works. And of course, the King James translators are right. We don't have to have a standard translation. We already have a standard, the inspired Hebrew and Greek. The fourth point, the next argument that the Douay-Rheims translators make in favor of translating from the Latin Vulgate instead of the Hebrew and Greek, is that the Vulgate is grave, majestic, and impartial. Those are their adjectives. I've certainly heard King James defenders call the King James Version majestic, and I happen to agree wholeheartedly. My question is only whether the original Hebrew and Greek sounded quite that majestic to their original hearers. In some places, I think so, like the grand poetry of some wonderful psalms. But in most places in Scripture, I think not. In the New Testament, especially, I know enough Greek to say that the New Testament authors almost always used the regular, normal, common Greek of the time, instead of the classic Greek that they could have used if they wanted to be majestic. The Douay-Rheims translators argued that because the Latin Vulgate predates their current church controversies, it can be regarded as impartial. I've heard echoes of this in King James defense. People often call the King James time-tested, for example, but I can't draw a direct parallel here between what the Catholic translator said in 1582 and what King James defenders say today. So I will move on to a fifth parallel. The Douay-Rheims translators also insist that the Vulgate is exact and precise according to the Greek, both the phrase and the word. This I hear all the time in defense of the King James Version. King James defenders insist that the King James is a word-for-word translation. They blow off all modern Bible translations as being only thought-for-thought. They say that the King James Version gives you what God actually said, while the modern translations give you what some arrogant, finite humans who just want to make money think he said. They say that the King James is untainted. The modern versions, they say, are pushing an agenda. It is so difficult to answer this charge because a truly fair answer would involve a lot of careful discussion of fine grammatical and lexicographical details in Hebrew and Greek and English. I'm compelled for time's sake to answer as I often must by generalizing. I've simply got to point out that every Bible translation in the entire history of the world, including the Douay-Rheims of 1582 and the King James of 1611, has had to strike some kind of balance between literal and formal, and less literal, you know, more functional dynamic renderings. Let me give you a quick example, actually from contemporary speech. You know, when you've been at a party and you think later of something that you should have said, you know, the clever comeback that you just wish had been on the tip of your tongue. In French, they actually have an idiom for this. It's called the wit of the staircase. And once it's explained to you, that phrase is very much understandable. Oh, as you're walking down away from the party, you're thinking of the thing to say. But if you don't know the reference, the phrase will be meaningless, like "you're pulling my leg" was once to a French speaker that I know. Do you translate idioms like these literally, expecting readers to figure them out from context? Or do you give an equivalent idiom in English? Or do you remove the idiom and just give the overall literal meaning? Every translator in the entire history of the world has had to deal with this question, because idioms are a natural element of all languages. Just go to the TIPS site, Translation Insights and Perspectives. You will see hundreds of instances of this sort of thing from Bible translators around the world. Don't get me wrong, it is possible to make an inaccurate translation of some sentence or other, or some word or other. But if competent people do their best, we should remember that Rome wasn't built in a day, but it can be destroyed in one. It's a ton of hard work to make a good Bible translation. It's lazy, easy work to snipe at and discredit Bible translations, to destroy other people's trust in them. Just like I don't trust car salesmen who tell me that all other car salesmen are cheats, I don't trust someone who blows off basically all Bible translations out there except for one. As one of my teachers said to me once, when Bible translations go wrong, they tend to go wrong obviously and horribly, not subtly wrong. And that usually means that they're produced by sectarians or crackpots, as I've talked about on this channel recently. The Douay-Rheims translators do give a few instances of alleged mistranslations in Protestant English Bibles, and they were not dummies. But what you'll find almost every time you look into a discussion like this among competent Christian people is that there is a reason why the King James translators had marginal notes offering alternate translations. It is simply the case that in many, many minor places in Scripture, equally competent people translate the same phrase in slightly different ways, and for good reasons too, reasons they will give you if you go looking. Sixth, the final reason why the Douay-Rheims translators give for using the Latin Vulgate as their base text instead of the Hebrew and Greek focuses on the New Testament, and it's taken straight from the Peter Ruckman playbook. I am not kidding here. I am completely serious. Just listen to this. I'm going to read this word for word. It's short. These 16th century Roman Catholics say that the Latin Vulgate is, quote, truer than the vulgar Greek text itself. Now, by this vulgar Greek testament, I believe they mean copies of the Greek New Testament that were then available, even though those copies go back in good measure to one of their own, namely Erasmus of Rotterdam. They elaborate that the Vulgate is not only better than all other Latin translations, but than the Greek text itself in those places where they disagree. The Catholic translators say that variants in the Greek text available indicate that the Greek has been corrupted in the past, which is rather convenient, isn't it? Because it ignores the variants among copies of the Latin Vulgate, which itself had to go through several recensions or official edits over time. More importantly, however, these Catholic scholars are treating a translation of the Bible as better and more reliable than the Hebrew and Greek in which the Bible was originally inspired. The Latin translation, the Vulgate, even corrects the Greek, they say, taking a classic Ruckmanite view. Will the real Jesuit please stand up? Effectively, all versions of King James defense end up doing something like this, as I showed in my video on 10 ways to avoid Ruckmanism. Many King James defenders just don't know that they're doing this. They sincerely think that the King James perfectly matches the Textus Receptus of the New Testament, which perfectly matches the originals. They aren't aware that there is no the Textus Receptus, but rather multiple Texti Recepti. Those who are aware of this fact pretty much always do what the Douay-Rheims translators did back in 1582. They treat the textual critical decisions of a certain set of translators as perfect. Wherever Jerome made a particular textual choice, these Catholics made that the standard. Wherever the King James translators made a particular textual choice, today's King James defenders make their choices the standard. And I'm actually not making a guilt by association argument in this video. I am not saying that King James onlyism is wrong, because Roman Catholics made the same arguments, or similar ones, of course, centuries ago. Roman Catholics can make good arguments for things, including the Trinity, for example. We share the same beliefs about the full deity of the Father, Son, and Spirit. And this is very important. I am actually making another kind of argument, the kind where I ask King James defenders to realize that with only a tiny little bit of elbow grease, all of your arguments can be used in support of a different translation. And in fact, some of your very common arguments in King James onlyism actually work better for the Latin Vulgate than they do for the King James Version. No Christian Bible translation can possibly beat the Latin Vulgate for longevity of use and for widespread trust all over Europe for centuries. As I've mentioned on this channel now a number of times, there are quite a lot of Ethiopians who believe that their Bible is the perfect translation. I prefer the view of the King James translators, which is also here in this book, and let me read it to you. They actually reference the Douay-Rheims. I wonder if you can catch the reference that I'm about to read. They say, "The very meanest translation of the Bible, in English, set forth by men of our profession, for we have seen none of theirs of the whole Bible as yet, containeth the word of God, nay, is the word of God, as the king's speech which he uttered in Parliament, being translated into French, Dutch, Italian, and Latin, is still the king's speech, though it be not interpreted by every translator with the like grace, nor peradventure so fitly for phrase, nor so expressly for sense everywhere." The Douay-Rheims actually shows up at the beginning of that quote, in the parenthesis. It appears that the King James translators were prepared to call the Catholic Bible the Word of God. They just hadn't had a chance to see the whole thing yet. They hadn't gone through it all. Indeed, the Catholic New Testament was finished in 1582. I read to you its preface. But the Old Testament was not finished until just before the King James went to print, almost 30 years later. Indeed, those Catholic translators who were dragged kicking and screaming into their work were not in any hurry. But the more important point of this quotation from the King James preface is that the King James translators were not so exclusive. They did not pick one translation, even theirs, and call it the be-all and end-all. This is the biblical way, and therefore the Protestant way. It is good to have multiple translations, and if you try to legislate for other Christians that they must use one and only one translation, you end up condemning as corrupt the faithful work of other translators.